Hello, my lovely friends. Many of you have informed me that you have exam in the month of June for TLS Pedagogy. So here I am to help you once again. But before I start the video, let me clarify one thing. One of the viewers, she emailed me and she said that this exam seems to be very difficult for her. She thinks she will not be able to do it. Things appear seem to be very difficult. Things seem to be very lengthy. It's very difficult to manage time. But that is how it is. Let me sound very blunt, but this is the reality. It's not an easy job. You have to devote your maximum time to this test. It's not that you can skim through the concepts, you can skip a lot and you can pass. It will not happen like that. It's a Herculean task. You have to give your blood, sweat and tears to this task. You have to devote maximum time. Go through everything mentioned in all the four standards, because you don't know what are the things going to be given in the exam. In fact, prepare extra, practice a lot of quizzes, do whatever you can to go through the exam in the very first attempt. And as I gave you the example of a viewer that she informed me previously in the email after giving the exam, that she thought she would fail. But I told her, by knowing the extent of preparation that she told me about, she said that she had made notes from my videos, she had gone through all my notes, her notes as well. I told her already that there is no way that you will fail, because your preparation speaks for itself. I know you will pass, and she did pass the exam, and inshallah, hopefully you will also. So this video is about the recent most concept. My friends who appeared in the TLS Pedagogy exam in the month of April, they informed me that they got plenty of questions about this topic, at least two or three. So you have a high scope of getting these concepts, these questions about this topic. So let's not wait any further. Let me unfold the mystery. This topic is about the topic of readiness. You are also going to get some questions about readiness in school, student readiness, which is based on Edward Thorndike's theory. Piaget also discussed this concept in his theory as well. So I've explained everything in detail. Let's not wait any further and see what I have in store for you. Stick around with me till the end of the video. There is a sample question, scenario based question for you, which is going to help you. Not only that, just a humble request. Many people watch the video, but very few hit the like button. Please, it's very important for my motivation and my stability on YouTube, as I'm new here. So hit the like button before you proceed further. So let's start the video. Video is about a very important topic. The badge who appeared for TLS Pedagogy exam in the month of April informed me about some unique topics that were not mentioned in the pedagogy guide, but they got some questions about those topics. So this is one of them. So without any further delay, let's start the video. It's about the laws of learning, or Thorndike's readiness theory. So let's see what I have in store for you. See what law of readiness is all about. It says that individuals learn best when they are physically, mentally, and emotionally ready to learn. So these three domains play a very vital role in learning. Learning can only take place when a student is physically in a perfect condition, a student is also in perfect state of mind, and a student is also not having any emotional issues at all. So you know, this scenario is extremely relatable. You can see in your class, based on practical experience, that if a student is having a headache or any other physical problem, maybe an injury or something, student will not focus on learning unless and until that problem, the headache, is gone, or that injury is healed, or the pain is gone. Likewise, if a student is having any emotional issues, maybe a student had a fight with his best friend, or a student is having some emotional issues in personal life, having some issues related to parents, so a student will be disturbed in class. I remember I had a student many years ago. I had a student, and suddenly I saw that she was quite depressed, and she had cuts on her hand. So after the class, I called her outside. I called her separately, and I tried to counsel her, and I asked her in a very friendly way if I could help her, because I had seen the cuts on her hand, on her wrist. So she told me that you know, there is a problem going on in her life. Parents are getting separated, so she's extremely upset. So that was an emotional trauma that she was going through. There was a, you know, the family was going to face a very difficult stage of life. That's why she was not willing to learn at all. So parents were called and counseled, and the problem was resolved somehow. So all these things play a very vital role when it comes to learning. All these three domains play a very important role.
So it's a law which states that learning is dependent upon the learner's readiness to act. Unless a learner is physically, mentally, and emotionally ready to learn, it will not take place, which facilitates the strengthening of the bond between the stimulus and the response. Thus, an athlete who is highly motivated and eager to learn is more likely to be receptive to learning than the one who's poorly motivated. I can give you another example. Let's say there is student A who has to go for immigration. That's why he needs a very high band score in IELTS. So when he's preparing for IELTS exam, he's fully motivated, because his willingness plays a very important role. A student is extremely willing and to move abroad. That's why he or she needs a higher band score. That's why he would strive his best to get an ideal band score. But in scenario two, let's say there is a parent who says to his son, parents tell their son that, you are free, this is spring break, just give it a try, you can appear for IELTS exam, because their parents want their son to get engaged in a constructive manner in a nice activity. So in case of the second student is not motivated at all, there is no stimulus at all, he's just passing time, so he might not be so much motivated to get a higher band score, so he would just appear for the sake of appearing in the exam. Compared to that, in scenario A, student A will put in his maximum effort because he needs an ideal band score so that he gets his immigration done. So readiness plays the role of a very important role for learning to happen. So what's the concept of readiness? It says that the process of readiness involves recognizing the need to change. As soon as a person or a student realizes the benefits of learning and he is willing to learn, that let's say a student is fully motivated that I have to take the first position in the class or I need to pass the exam, that's why I need to learn. So this motivation brings a change in the student and he is willing to learn. So inner readiness is the additional element if education should empower and lead towards action. Inner readiness plays a very important role. You should be willing and ready to learn. So let's have a look in detail. What is readiness to learn? Readiness refers to how well equipped a pupil is to learn. You can tag this in your mind that it has something to do with how well equipped a pupil is to learn, including circumstantial and environmental factors. So both of these factors play an important role, and you can have a scenario based questions. So a student's circumstances should also support him to learn. His environment should also be made a very congenial environment so that the learning should take place. A student with a low readiness to learn may be encumbered by difficult personal circumstances in his or her life, or a lower emotional or physical maturity. So basically, a student's readiness to learn depends on circumstantial and environmental factors. So anything that affects physical or psychological comfort, such as pain, fatigue, anxiety, or fear, can affect a person's ability and motivation to learn. Therefore, the environment and the physical and the mental state of mind should be in an ideal scenario so that the learning can take place in an ideal environment. So Edward Thorndike gave the law of readiness. Let's see. Actually, he gave three laws: law of readiness, law of exercise, law of effect, and altogether they are called law of learning. So according to him, law of readiness is: individuals learn best when they are ready to learn, when they are willing to learn and understand the reason for learning. Once they are fully convinced and willing, only then learning will take place. For example, there is a student A who's sitting in the class and he thinks that he needs to be promoted to the next class. That's why he must study. So he is willing, he is convinced, that's why he is ready to grab the information. On the other hand, there is a student who is having a mental problem or emotional issue. Let's say a student is had a clash with his best friend. So he is emotionally disturbed. Learning will not take place because of lack of emotional readiness. Or a student has a headache, there is physical problem is there. So a student is not well physically, that's why he's not ready physically to absorb the information. So that's why learning will not happen. It can only happen when a student is ready to learn, remember this. So this is what this law is all about. There is also law of exercise. It says that repetition is basic to learning. Things most often repeated are easiest remembered. That's why there is a method called the drill method, in which students are taught with the help of drilling. For example, you must have seen at primary level, students are taught with the help of nursery rhymes. They are given a lot of drilling. For example, they are repeatedly shown poems, nursery rhymes, where they have to say, repeat again and again, because this is how they learn. Through repetition, they learn a lot. So this is what law of exercise is all about. Similarly, there is law of effect. Learning will always be much more effective when a feeling of satisfaction accompanies the process. So the effect plays a very important role. The effect of learning plays a great role in learning. So the sense of satisfaction that you have achieved something, it promotes learning. So all these laws are related to laws of learning. So these principles have been discovered, tested, and used in practical situations, and they provide additional insight into what makes people learn most effectively. This theory was developed by Edward Thorndike, and you might get questions based on these scenarios concerning law of readiness, law of exercise, or law of effect. Piaget also spoke about this theory, because according to his theory of readiness, his approach to learning is a readiness approach, and he says that readiness approaches in developmental psychology, they emphasize that children cannot learn something until maturation gives them certain prerequisites. So in order to grab difficult pieces of information, certain prerequisites are required. If a student has reached that level of maturation, only then he can grab difficult information. So this is what his theory of readiness is all about. So the ability to learn any cognitive content is always related to their stage of intellectual development. If a student has reached a particular stage of intellectual development, then that means he has reached that stage of maturation that he can grab information. So it has everything to do with his stage of development, whether he has reached that stage of development, where he is equipped with all the requirements, all the prerequisites needed for absorbing that piece of information, then learning can take place. So children who are at a certain stage cannot be taught the concept of a higher stage. You can take the example, for example, a grade 3 student cannot absorb difficult pieces of information. For example, if you take examples of science, there are many different processes involved. So you gradually teach them. Grade 3 science is very easy compared to grade 8 science or grade 9 science, because books have been developed according to their stages, the age group. So this theory can be explained with the help of that at lower level, at primary level, students are not willing to grab difficult concepts. That's why concepts are kept very easy, very simple, plain, so that they can absorb simple facts, simple things easily. And gradually they go towards complex things, because with age they reach a certain level where they can grab complex concepts as well. So what is meant by school readiness? School readiness means each child enters school ready to engage and benefit from early learning experiences that best promotes the child's success. Approaches to learning, health and physical well-being, language and communication development, social and emotional development, all these factors play a very vital role. You can make a note of it. You can note down these details so that if a scenario-based question comes, so these are the things which affect school readiness, that is health, physical well-being, language and communication development, social and emotional development. So you can just apply it to real life scenarios. For example, if a student is not having an ideal health condition, Obviously, he is not willing to learn. I've seen practically sometimes a student is having a stomach pain or any other pain. So I can see that the student is lying down and student is not willing to learn at all. So we have to send the student to the sick room, and the nurse, sometimes the nurse comes and gives medicine, and only then when the student is stable and in perfect health condition, learning takes place. Similarly, if there are communication problems, learning cannot happen. If you have a new student who's come from another school system who has some communication issues, then obviously you need some extra help to make the student understand the concepts. So same goes for the emotional development as well. So all these factors are concerned with school readiness, that learning can only happen if these factors are in an ideal condition. Let's encapsulate all the points related to Thorndike's first three laws. The first one is the law of readiness, which implies the degree of preparedness and eagerness to learn. I'll give you a scenario. Let's say there is a student A who has to apply for immigration and he needs an ideal band score. So he has to appear for IELTS exam. So obviously his aim is very high and he's fully eager to get the highest band score. That's why he's fully prepared to get the highest band score. So he's willing. That's why he will strive his best to get the highest band score and he will absorb the information. Whereas there's a student B whose parents just told him that, okay, just to pass time, appear for IELTS exam. Do you think he's fully willing to learn? Do you think he's fully prepared to learn? He has been pushed by his parents just to pass time to get engaged in an activity. So you can make out the difference. The student A is fully motivated and prepared to learn and he has a goal in front of him. So that goal makes him eager to learn and prepared to learn. That's why he is ready, he is more willing to learn. So this is what law of readiness is all about. Whereas student B is not ready, not willing to learn, not prepared to learn. So that's why learning might not take place. He will appear for the in the exam just for the sake of appearing and fulfilling the wish of his parents, but there is no willingness involved, therefore learning might not happen. Similarly, there is law of exercise, which says that things are most often repeated are best remembered. So, repetition is the key to success. You have seen that when we make children learn the tables in maths, obviously we repeat them a lot. So they always learn through drilling. Similarly, they learn with the help of nursery rhymes when they are in the lower grades, because we know that repetition will make them learn. There is the last law, which is law of effect, which is based on emotional reaction and motivation of the student. Learning is strengthened with pleasant or satisfying feeling, while unpleasant feelings tend to do otherwise. So this has to do a lot with the emotional well-being and the physical well-being of the student. And the sense of satisfaction that is gained when some learning takes place. So you can see that whenever you are you praise a student feels very satisfied that I replied the teacher in a nice manner, in an impressive manner, and the teacher knows that I gave the right answer. A student feels satisfied. That's why it's very, very important to encourage the student so that the law of effect can happen and it can come into existence and student can feel satisfied. So this satisfaction leads to towards more learning to take place in class. So that was a short video. Let's review a sample question. This will enable you to prepare for similar scenario based questions about Thorndike's three laws, that is law of readiness, law of exercise, or law of effect. So let's review what our question is all about. Jane tries a new study strategy to prepare for an important test, then gets an A on that test. According to Thorndike's law of effect, how is Jane most likely to react? Number one, Jane will probably believe her teacher is simply rewarding effort, not her mastery of the subject. But we studied that law of effect has everything to do with the self-satisfaction. The learner feels satisfied, that's why learning happens. So this goes against that, so we can cross out this option. Jane will probably attribute her good grade to external factors such as luck. This has nothing to do with Thorndike's law of effect, so we can cross out this option, because it has a lot to do with personal readiness, personal satisfaction, mental satisfaction, emotional satisfaction. So Jane will be less likely to use that study strategy the next time she prepares for a test. She got an A on the subject on that test, so why would she think to discard that strategy at all? So why would she not think of not using the strategy next time? So we can cross out this option. Jane will probably use that strategy the next time she prepares for the test. So obviously this getting an A must have given her satisfaction. That's why she would definitely go for it, and she would choose the same strategy to appear to get the same ideal score next time. So this will be your right option. New topics that I've included in my list of videos, because the recent most batch told me that they got a question about this. I wish you the very best of luck for your exam. Please, for my support and motivation, hit the like button and share this video in your circle of friends, whoever is going to appear, and drop your feedback in the form of comments on my channel. I'll see you in my next video very soon. Best of luck. In case you need to know anything, please let me know in the comment section.